Morning, brothers and sisters. Welcome to Sunday worship. I'm going to read Psalm 103, 1 to 5. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we praise you and offer our thanksgiving to you. In this Thanksgiving season, we remember what you have done in our life. You love us so much that you forgave our sins, save us, and give us eternal life. You healed our diseases and provide our needs, and you guide us to live an abundant life. Thank you for your love and compassion. This morning, we join together to worship you and to sing praises to you because you are worthy of our praises. We pray for your presence, and the Holy Spirit prepares our heart to worship you with joyful hearts and to listen to your word. May our worship be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Good morning. This morning we have not a very new song, but a song that we haven't sung for a long time. You are holy, a Prince of Peace. Let's worship him, and let's rise and sing this song together. You are holy, Prince of Peace. You are holy,
you are holy,
you are mighty,
you are mighty,
you are worthy,
you are worthy,
worthy of praise,
worthy of praise.
I will follow,
I will listen,
I will love you. All of my days, I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will love you.
All of my days.
I will sing and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. I will sing to and worship the King who is worthy. I will love and adore him. I will bow down before him. You're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. You're my Prince of Peace, and I will live my life for you. Yeah. Our next song, Turn Your Eyes Unto Jesus. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look for in his wonderful face. And the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and praise. Turn your eyes to the hillside, where justice and mercy embrace. There the Son of God gave his life for us, and our measureless death was erased. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our pride. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Turn your eyes to the morning and see Christ the Lion away. What a glorious dawn, fear of death is gone, for we carry his life in our veins. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Turn your eyes to the heavens. Our King will return for his own. Every knee will bow, every tongue will shout, all glory to Jesus alone. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Jesus, to you we lift our eyes. Jesus, our glory and our prize. We adore you, behold you, our Savior ever true. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. Oh Jesus, we turn our eyes to you. You all may be seated.
morning. I'll be reading from James 4, verse 1 to 12. Let's take a moment to turn to our Bibles. James 4, verse 1. What causes quarrels and what causes fight among you? Is it not this, that your passions are at war within you? You desire and do not have, so you murder. You covet and cannot obtain, so you fight and quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. You ask and you do not receive because you ask wrongly to spend it on your passions. You adulterous people, do you not know that friendship with this world is enmity with God? Therefore, whoever wishes to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you suppose it is to no purpose that the scripture says he yearns jealousy over the spirit that he has made to dwell in us? But he gives more grace. Therefore, it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourself before the Lord, and he will exalt you. Do not speak evil against one another, brothers. The one who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks evil against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is only one lawgiver and judge, he who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you to judge your neighbor? This is the word of God.
Brothers and sisters, today is the Lord's Day. We remember Jesus. I want to refer to John chapter 1 and chapter 3. This all tells us, how deep the Father's love for us. He sent his only Son to suffer and die for us. But this is the greatest gift of our lifetime. We want to thank God and appreciate what he has done for us, and we're gonna sing it together. Let's all rise. But before we sing the song, I'd like to go through read a few verses. Okay, this is John 1. It says, all things, verse 3, all things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. Okay, and verse 9, the true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. Verse 12, but to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. How wonderful. Let's all rise and sing this song, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. Now, the music is a little bit long, but we want to make it as beautiful as possible for our Lord, and our Lord is beautiful. Let's begin. Let's sing together. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure,
that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of hearing loss. The father turns his face away as wounds which part the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed, I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. Not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer. But this I know with all my heart, his wounds have paid my ransom. John 3:16, God so loved the world, he gave his only son to us. That's all. Seated. Be seated. Thank you.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Let's pray. Father, truly, how deep is your love for us. Father, we know that you are the God who gives good things, good gifts to your children. You are the God who knows what is best for us. And you are the God who gives generously, Father, according to our needs. So, Lord, we pray now that you would give good things to us. Through your word, Father, we know that according to your word, you give what is best for us, according to our needs, so that we might be strong and that our hearts may be filled with gladness in you. So, Lord, we pray that you will use this time for that now. We pray for that now, God. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. All right, well, good to see everyone this morning as we come again. We open up scripture as we look into God's word. Let me move this down a bit. It's a bit caught. Sorry about that, guys. Okay. Now, our passage this morning is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. We're just going to be looking at verses 1 to 4 this morning. I know we just sat down, but can I ask all of us to stand up again as we read God's word this morning? Our passage this morning is 1 Corinthians 3, verses 1 to 4. But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you are not ready for it, and even now you are not yet ready. For you are still of the flesh. For while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not being merely human? This is the word of God. Please have a seat. Now, one of the greatest insults that we could give to another grown-up, another person who is already grown up, one of the greatest insults we can possibly give to that person is to tell them to grow up. Tell another grown-up that you need to grow up. Because implied is this person is already grown, already a grown-up, but by the way that they think and by the way that they are behaving, they need to grow up. That is so insulting. It's so insulting to say to someone, you are not a child anymore, but you are still behaving like a child. And you, although you are already a grown up, you need to grow up. That is so insulting. That is such an insulting thing to say to another person. And that is exactly what Paul says to the Corinthian church here in 1 Corinthians chapter 3. He's saying to the church in Corinth, you know, you are already a grown-up people, but you need to grow up. Oh, this is hard words that we find here in this chapter. And it wasn't easy for them to take when Paul said it to them. One thing I hate is pride. And the pride that I hate the most is my pride. I hate my pride. I hate my pride because my pride is a thing that not only harms others, my pride harms myself. My pride makes me blind to see where I still need to grow. I hate my pride. The Corinthian church here was a church that was too proud to grow. They needed to grow. There were ways that they still needed to grow, but they were so proud of who they were. They felt like they had so many things to be proud of. They were too proud to grow because their pride made them blind to where they still needed to grow. And so here in this passage, Paul had to tell them, you have to grow up. You need to grow up. And you know, I don't know about you, but sometimes I need these kind of hard words because I know my pride causes me to be blind to where I still need to grow. And if I never receive this kind of teaching the way I need to, I will never grow the way I still need to grow. And this is why Paul gave these words to the Corinthian church this morning. Now, The title I chose for this sermon is A Church's Desperate Need. A church's desperate need is maturity. A church's desperate need is maturity. We all know that every church has different needs. We know our church has our own needs, but a church's desperate need, a great need, perhaps the greatest need is maturity. An outline for us this morning, very simple, 2 points. Point number one, every church's desperate need for maturity. And when I say every church, I mean big and small, rich and poor, black or white. Every single church has the same desperate need. No matter how different the church is, every church has the same need. And it's a desperate need. Every church's desperate need is for maturity. And number two, we're going to see a very painful mark of immaturity. A very painful mark of immaturity. This is a mark of immaturity that showed up in this church in Corinth. And it's not just, it was a very painful mark because it causes painful things to happen to a church. A very painful mark of immaturity. So again, point number one, every church's desperate need for maturity. Number two, a very painful mark of immaturity. And I'll finish up with just a couple points of application. All right, so let's begin. First, every church's desperate need for maturity. Every church's desperate need for maturity. I was once a part of a church that went through a very, very expensive building program. It was very expensive. One of those building programs that has a bunch of zeros behind it because it was a very, very, very expensive building project. And before we started to pursue that building, we asked two simple questions. Two questions to determine if this move should be made. The first question was this: are we financially ready? This is a very, very expensive thing. Are we financially ready? The second question was this: are we spiritually ready? Are we spiritually ready? Looking back now, the money was the easy part. By far, the money was the easy part. Even though it was very, very expensive, the money was easy compared to the other thing. Are we spiritually ready? This is something that every church desperately needs, which is maturity. Look with me at verse 1, please. But I, brothers, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. You are not a child, but you are behaving like a child. Paul calls the church in Corinth infants in Christ. Paul says to them, you are not spiritual people. I could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of flesh, as infants in Christ. Look at verse 3-4. And notice how he emphasizes how fleshy, how fleshly, how human they are. Verse 3, for you are still of the flesh, for while there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving only in a human way? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not being, what, merely human? Notice Paul makes a contrast here. In verse 1, he begins by saying, I could not address you as what? As spiritual people. But he says, you are what? You are acting as people of flesh. You are still of the flesh. Are you not of the flesh? You're behaving only in a human way. Are you not being merely human? He is contrasting being spiritual and being of the flesh. What Paul is saying to the church in Corinth is this: Though you are indwelled by the Spirit of God, you are filled inside you with the Spirit of God, by the way that you are thinking and by the way that you are behaving, you are showing that you do not have Him inside of you. You claim to be a spiritual people, meaning we have the Spirit of God inside of us. But by the way that you are living, you show that you do not have the Spirit of God inside of you. This is what Paul was saying to the church in Corinth. Paul was telling them, you need to grow up. Oh, these are very painful words. These are hard words to take. These are very hard words to take. Simply put, if we have the Spirit inside of us, it shows. The church in Corinth, if they had the Spirit of God inside of them, it should show. For us, EV3, well, if we have the Spirit of God inside of us, it should show in the way that we live. The fruit of the Spirit is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Are we a church that's marked by gentleness, for example? Are we a church that's evidently a church that's marked by self-control, for example? If we have the Spirit of God inside of us, it should show for them by the way that they were living, by the way they were thinking and behaving. It did not show. It did not show. So Paul was telling them, I cannot call you spiritual. I can only call you people fleshly, people of the flesh, people who are acting as mere humans. I've seen extremely, extremely gifted people in the church before. I've seen guys who are so gifted that when I look at, for example, this extremely gifted person, and I look at all the pastors, I'm like, this guy's more gifted. I've seen extremely hardworking people in the church, so hardworking. I'm looking at all the pastors, from the youngest to the oldest to the youngest. This guy, I think this guy's even more hardworking. I've seen guys who are so passionate about Christian causes. And I'm looking at the pastors and I'm like, this guy, I think he has more passion. But then when I see the way that they go about their work, when I see the way they think and the way that they behave in their work, something just seemed off. Even though the results seem to be so impressive to the eyes, and the way that they were was so commendable in many ways, the way that they went about their work, the way that they thought and talked and dealt with people, there was just something off about it. And it's hard to put into words. But when we look at this passage this morning, it's possible for some to become church leaders when here, according to what Paul was saying, they were spiritual infants. There is a desperate need for maturity for every church, for every Christian, or else, as Paul says, you are still acting as of the flesh, not of the Spirit. Now, as we look at this passage here, especially in verse 1, I want us to see there's good news and there's bad news. There's good news and bad news. The good news is, of course, here, they are Christians. The ones that Paul was talking to, the church in Corinth, those who are going to read and listen to this letter, the good news is that they were actually true Christians, born again, regenerate. They were true Christians. How do I know this? Notice again in verse 1, what does Paul call them? It says, but I, brothers and sisters, could not address you as spiritual people, but as people of flesh, as infants in Christ. Notice, Paul calls them, what, brothers and sisters. Because according to Paul, these ones, the people who were reading his letter, were truly his brothers and sisters in Christ. They were true Christians. And notice, it says they were infants in Christ. Yeah, they're infants, they're not very mature, they still need to grow up, but they are in Christ. They are Christians. That's the good news here. The good news is that they were Christians. But of course, there's bad news. The bad news is that though they were Christians, they were very immature Christians. They were brothers and they were sisters. Paul could say, you are my brother, you are my sister, but you are still very not spiritual. He says, you are in Christ, but you are mere infants in Christ. Though they were Christians, they were still very immature Christians. That's the good news and the bad news. Though they were Christians, they were very immature Christians. But there is great news out of this passage. The good news and the bad news, but there is great news. That though they were so immature, though they were true Christians, but they were very immature Christians. But even though they were so immature as Christians, they were still actual true Christians. They were still brothers and sisters in Christ. They were still justified, and they still will be glorified. You see, even though they were infants, they were in Christ. Even though they were not spiritual people, they were truly brothers and sisters in Christ. They were still Christians. The point is this. The reason is because our salvation is not dependent on how spiritual and how mature we are. Our salvation does not depend on how much I or you, how much we grow in Christ. Our salvation is solely dependent on what Christ did in his life and his death and his resurrection. Yes, I may be an infant in Christ. Yes, I may be so immature in Christ. Yes, I may be such a bad Christian, but my salvation does not depend on how much I grow, on the work that I do to grow. My salvation only depends on how much Christ did, in how much he did to save me in his life, death, and resurrection. The exceeding righteousness of Christ, earned by Christ, covers all of my inadequate righteousness. And that's the same for us this morning. The Corinthian church was so immature, but they were still Christians, still justified, still to be glorified, because their Savior was so great to save them. Now, recently, when you go on a plane in these times, you need to wear a face mask all the time, right? And if it's a 5-hour flight, you've got to keep that face mask on for 5 hours. It can be very painful. Sometimes I see an infant being brought on to the plane, and an infant needs to leave that face mask on for 5 hours. That's really hard to do. If I'm in a plane and I hear behind me crying and screaming on the plane, and I turn around, it's an infant, I'm like, well, that's not good, but you kind of understand. That's a long flight. An infant needs to keep that face mask on the whole time. That's understandable. But what if I turn around and I see it's not an infant, but it's a 50-year-old man crying and screaming because of face mask on? No, all of a sudden you're like, no, that is not good. That is not acceptable. That is not acceptable, because you are grown up, but you are still acting as an infant. You need to grow. You need to grow. And that's exactly what Paul was saying to the church of Corinth here in 1 Corinthians 3. They need to grow. And this is true for every church. Every church has the same desperate need, which is this, which is maturity. Which is maturity. This church was lacking in maturity. They were filled with many other good things. They were filled with very impressive things, but they lacked this one thing. They lacked maturity. And Paul had to call them to grow up. So let me ask us, how are we doing in this, brothers and sisters? What do we have? What do we don't have? Well, do we have this? Do we have maturity? You see, maturity has always been the ultimate goal. Maturity is always every church's desperate need, because maturity has always been the ultimate goal. It's always been the ultimate goal, the final goal, the chief goal for every church. Listen to Colossians 1:28. Him we proclaim, Christ, Him we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone, what? Mature in Christ. Going on to verse 29, for this I toil. For this I toil, that the church in Colossae might be mature in Christ. For this I toil. The Apostle Paul saying, this is what I work myself to the bone for, that the church of Christ might be mature in Christ. For this I toil, struggling with all his energy that he powerfully works within me. You know, if you look on church websites, every church website has a mission statement. Right, this church has this mission statement, that church has that one. Everyone seems to have different mission statements. Well, this is the biblical. This is an extremely biblical mission. This is Paul's mission statement. He's saying, for this I toil. This is my mission statement for the church, that we may present everyone mature in Christ. Maturity is the goal. And maturity is Paul's goal for the church, because maturity is God's goal for every church. Let me say it one more time. Maturity is Paul's goal for this church, for that church, for every church. Maturity is Paul's goal because maturity is God's goal. It's God's goal for the church. I get this from Romans 8:29. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be what? To be conformed to the image of his son, conformity to Christ, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. Just here we find maturity defined. Maturity defined for the Christian is that the person is not only saved through the righteousness of Christ, but the Christian is conformed, or 2 Corinthians 3, transformed into the image of Christ. So that he actually possesses in his life the righteousness of Christ. The reason why Paul made it his goal for the church to be mature is because this is God's goal for every single church. Those whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to the image of his son. The final goal God had for the church, for every Christian, was conformity to the image of Christ, to be like Christ. Follow me as I follow Christ. This is God's goal for you. This is God's goal for me, that we will become like Christ, mature in Christ. And so this is Paul's goal for them. He does what God is doing. If God is doing this and Paul is doing this, it's not going to happen. But if God is doing this and Paul is doing this, That's what he should be doing. Every church's desperate need for maturity. Now, let's finish up with our second and final point, a very painful mark of immaturity. So Paul called them to maturity. Paul said, this is the goal for you, that you be mature in Christ, that you have maturity, that you are spiritual people. This is Paul's goal for them, maturity, a desperate need, maturity. We don't want to be infants. We want to be mature. We don't want someone to have to tell us to grow up. That's so painful to hear. Well, here we find a very painful mark of immaturity. And I use the word painful very intentionally. This is a painful thing when this shows up in a church. Look with me at verse 3. Here we find this very painful mark of immaturity. For you are still of the flesh. For while there is what? There is jealousy and strife. Jealousy and strife among you. Are you not of the flesh, behaving in only a human way? He's saying, if this is because these things are present among you, are you not of the flesh? Are you not lacking in true maturity? Because you have these things among you, jealousy and strife. And he goes on, for what one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos. Are you not being merely human? This is a very painful mark of immaturity in the church of Corinth, that they were divided, that they lacked unity in Christ, that there was jealousy and strife amongst them, leading to disunity in the church. And Paul says, because there is this among you, are you not being merely human? Are you not showing your lack of spiritual maturity? because there is this among you. This is a very painful mark of immaturity in the church. Notice he says in 3, verse 3 and 4, are you not behaving only in a human way? Are you not being merely human? Well, yeah, Paul, because I'm human. I'm behaving human because I'm human. No, of course, that's not what he's saying. He's saying you're being merely human. You're being merely human. See, we know conflicts happen in the world. We see nations going to war with nations. We see family members fighting with one another. We see people in the corporate world quarreling and fighting with one another. We know conflicts happen in the world, but the church is called to be different than the world. The church is called to be an example to the world. But here, the church of Corinth, the church is behaving just like the world in the way that they were fighting with one another in the church. Paul is saying, are you not being merely human? We know that this kind of stuff happens out there. We know this kind of stuff happens in the world. But this kind of stuff is happening right here among you inside the church. Paul is saying, are you not being merely human? Because the church is behaving just like the world. This is very painful, too. This is a very painful mark of immaturity in that church. But we know that these things happen inside the church. We know conflicts happen inside the church. People always say, where people are, what conflicts are. There's something inside of our hearts that just leads us to having conflicts with one another. But Paul is saying, no, not inside the church. Not inside the church. We know it happens out there, but not in here. It should not happen in here. Not inside of here. But we know conflicts do happen inside the church, right? We know from experience. We know from church history. We know that conflicts do happen inside the church. Again, James 4, 1, what Bonnie read, what causes quarrels? And what causes fights? Where? Among you. Among you. 1 Corinthians 1:11, for it has been reported to me by Chloe's people that there is quarreling. Where? Among you, my brothers. When it says among you, it's about the church, inside the church. Inside the church, conflicts do happen. It's always been this way. From the very beginning of the New Testament church, throughout church history, conflicts do happen inside the church, among you, the church. But even more, conflicts not only happen inside the church, conflicts even happen between the most devoted servants in the church. The most devoted ones, servants in the church, we find conflicts also happen. You guys probably know where I'm going, Philippians 4. I entreat, meaning I plead with you, I entreat Euodia, and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask you, true companion, to help these women who have labored, who have served side by side with me in the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. These were some of the main servants inside the church. Euodia and Syntyche, and these were the very ones who were having conflict inside the church. And Paul says, I heard, Euodia and Syntyche, these key servants in that church, they're fighting with each other. And so he says, I entreat Euodia, I entreat Syntyche, agree in the Lord. These were the ones who labored side by side with me in the gospel together with Clement. Right? So these were my fellow workers. We know conflicts happen inside the church, even amongst the most devoted servants of the church. But here, Paul says again, when that happens, we are behaving merely human. This is human. This is only human. This is merely human. This is of the flesh. This is not a mark of the Spirit indwelling. It's a very painful mark of immaturity. This is a short passage this week. Let me finish up with just a couple points of implications. We've seen every church's desperate need is maturity. The Corinthian church had so much that they felt they could boast about, but they lacked this, they lacked maturity. And Paul said, no, you are of the flesh. Maturity is needed by every church. That was true then, that's true today. This is Paul's goal for them. This should be our goal for us, because this is God's goal for us, that we become like Christ. Right? That we truly are the body of Christ. But we also saw a painful mark of immaturity, which is jealousy and strife, fighting within the church, leading to division. I follow Paul, I follow Apollos. Division inside the church. A couple points of application. Look, conflicts may happen inside the church, but we, the church, we need to know how to deal with conflict when it happens inside the church. And first, I wanted to mention the urgency of reconciliation. The urgency of reconciliation. Look, it's not that a church will always be conflict-free. No conflicts at all. But a church needs to also have this, even more so, urgency for reconciliation, to reconcile, to be reconciled. Conflicts may lead to division out there, but conflicts must be reconciled in here. Matthew 5, 23, so if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there, remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, what? Be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift, and then come. Notice where this person is. This person was at the altar. This person was at the altar, the inner courts of the temple, at the altar of God, about to do this very sacred act of worship to God, right before the Holy of Holies. He was in there so deep. This person was already at the altar, doing this most holy act of worship at the altar. But God says, stop. Go be reconciled first. Leave. Go and do it first. Be reconciled first. This is about the urgency of reconciliation. This is about the urgency, the urgent attitude that we have to be reconciled. For example, we're about to be at the Lord's table. This holy, this sacred act of worship. You are already at the altar. You are already at the Lord's table. You're about to put that bread into your mouth. But you remember your brother has something against you. There is a need to be reconciled with a brother or sister in Christ. Drop that bread at once. Go be reconciled. Then come and worship. Again, this is about the urgency of reconciliation. But also this. There needs to be the willingness to extend forgiveness. You know, one thing that Christians should know how to do better than anyone else in the world to extend forgiveness, knowing how much we have received forgiveness. Forgiveness should be something that Christians are the most abundant in. Forgiveness is something that we should love to see happen. Knowing that we have received it, we should be eager to extend it. Forgiveness should be our thing. Right? If the world doesn't know how to forgive, well, we should. We should know. That's our thing, forgiveness. Matthew 6:12, forgive us our debt as we also have forgiven our debtors. Just assume that we are people who forgive because we are people who are forgiven. Luke 17:3, pay attention to yourselves. If your brother sins, rebuke him, and if he repents, forgive him. If he sins against you seven times in a day and turns to you seven times saying, I repent, you must forgive him. Notice this is not an optional thing. This is a command for Christians. You must forgive. Ephesians 4:32, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. This is our thing. Forgiveness is our thing. Colossians 3:13, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you. Let me say it one more time. Forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Notice the standard of forgiveness. As God has forgiven, we forgive. Forgiveness is our thing. This is what we do. We are people of forgiveness. 2 Corinthians 7:11, so you should rather turn to forgive and comfort him, this sinner who has repented, or he may be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow, so that we would not be what? So that we would not be outwitted by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his designs. An unforgiving church has fallen into the trap of Satan, according to Paul in 2 Corinthians 2, to be outwitted by Satan, being ignorant of his designs. This unwillingness to extend forgiveness. Too often we hold on to grudges. Too often we are merciless in our hearts. Too often we harbor bitterness. Oh, I remember. I remember what that person did. Oh, I'm not going to let that go. Too often we harbor bitterness, but Scripture teaches us very clearly, if they have repented and unwillingness to forgive, their sin against you becomes your sin before God. This is about the willingness to extend forgiveness. This is our theme. The urgency to reconcile and the willingness to forgive. We must be people who know how to deal with conflict. Let's pray to God for these things. Father, these short verses here speak so much about what you call your church to be. God, we do pray that you will grow us in these ways. God, teach us these truths. Help us to remember Christ and the abundance of forgiveness that we have received in Christ as sinners, unworthy, but reconciled to you. Lord, may we be urgent to reconcile with one another, knowing that you do not tolerate a divided church. So, Lord, we do pray that you'll grow us in this way. Give us the wisdom. Give us the help that we need to be this way. Do this work in our hearts, God. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Now we come to the Lord's table. First week of the month, we take the Lord's Supper. Now, to help us to think through the Lord's Supper this week, I want to again look at that key passage in 1 Corinthians talking about the supper. But there's this very interesting part in 1 Corinthians 11 when we talk about the Lord's Supper. And it talks about those who are eating the supper in an unworthy manner. First Corinthians 11:27 says this, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and blood of the Lord. This is doing the Lord, taking the Lord's Supper in a way that is not right. It's an taking it in an unworthy manner. The question is this, what does it mean to take the supper in an unworthy manner? Are we doing it in a worthy manner? Or are we guilty of doing it in an unworthy manner? What does it mean? Well, we find the explanation in verse 20 of this passage. It says in verse 20, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. They are doing it in an unworthy manner because they are not taking the Lord's Supper. They are eating the bread, they are drinking the cup, but it is not the Lord's Supper that they're eating. They're doing it in such a wrong way that it's no longer the supper. It's just eating and drinking. And we find what they were doing so wrong was that they were doing it as a divided church. Listen to 1 Corinthians 11, verse 17 to 22. It says this, but in the following instructions I do not commend you, because when you come together, it is not for the better, but for the worse. When we come together on Sunday mornings, it's meant to be for the better. It's meant to benefit us, meant to edify us. But when they came together, it was not for the better, it was for the worse. It was to discourage, it was to tear down, not to build up. Verse 18, for in the first place, when you come together as a church, when they came together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you. And I believe it in part, for there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized. They were coming together physically, but they were actually divided relationally. They were a divided church, even though they came to the supper together. And so verse 20, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper that you eat. Yeah, you're eating food together, but this is not the Lord's Supper because you are a divided church. And here's what they were doing, verse 21. For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry, another gets drunk. What? Do you not have houses to eat and drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not. What they were doing in the Lord's Supper is some people were feasting, getting drunk on so much they had, and others, the poor in the church, were starving. They were a divided church, divided, not united in heart. And because they were divided at the Lord's table, Paul says, this is not, you're not taking the Lord's Supper. This is an unworthy manner, because you're doing it as a divided church. You see, here we find the high standard for unity God has for his church. This is about the high standard of unity that God calls his church to have. That Christ says, if you come to this table as a divided church, non-reconciled people, this is not worthy of this table. There may be no divisions at this table. At this table, there may be no divisions. Because if there are divisions at this table, it is doing it in an unworthy manner. So we're going to now take the supper, and I want to encourage us just to spend some time and pray. Pray to God that as we looked at 1 Corinthians 3 this morning, that you pray for the unity of this church. And not just people in this room. We are a church with three congregations. Pray for the unity of this church. And as you pray, remember Christ, who loved his church and gave himself up for her, to unite her and to save her, to love her. And when you're ready, just come up, take the bread and the cup, go back to your seat, receive the supper, and we'll finish up our time with a song. And if there's any need for repentance, of non-reconciliation, let this time also be a time of confession, and perhaps even pursuing reconciliation in this church, because at this table, the Lord allows for no division in his body. Let's pray.
Thank you, Pastor, for the message. Before we sing the next song, I'd like to say a few things that I picked up during the sermon. hate my pride, he said. Pride caused problem. Small problem, there's division in among ourselves. But big problem is like causing war or fight. So let our God's word remind us that we are still of the flesh. In Corinthians 3, verse 6, Paul said, I planted Apollos water, but God gave the growth. So we need God to help us. Verse 20, again, the Lord knows all the thoughts of the wise, and they are futile. I guess it's worthless. So let no one boast in man. All things are yours. That means all things belong to the Lord. God owns us. Everything we do, everything we have is provided by the Lord. So the next thing I want to introduce this song. I'm curious the story behind the songwriter, especially this song As the Deer is very popular, but the story of the writer is unpopular. So where this song is coming from, it was written in 1981 by a gentleman named Martin Nystrom. This very unpopular history of writing this song was he was on his way on summer sometime, and then he was supposed to travel to Dallas, Texas, to meet up a girl. So he was heartbroken. So a friend told him that you should fast and turn back to the Lord. And one day he read the Bible after 19 days fasting, drinking just water. And he read the Bible, turned to Psalm 42. And Psalm 42, as the deer panted for water. That's how we start the whole song. So let's all rise and sing this song together, As the Deer. And today we have our brother Clement on the violin. Thank you. Let's all begin.
As the deer panted for the water, so my soul longed after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other. my spirit you. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. Seated.
Welcome again to the Sunday service today. Please join for the Sunday school today in the chapel at 11 o'clock. Today we will talk about how can we glorify God? So please join for Sunday school. And the English prayer meeting is on Sunday at 8:30. So please come join us on Sunday to pray for the church and pray for each other every Sunday. And next Sunday, we will have an annual membership meeting at 2 p.m. in the sanctuary, and we assume. So both members and non-members are welcome to attend. So please join us. And in the meeting, we will vote for the church budget for next year and the new board members. And the way to cast the voting, please see the bulletin. There are three different ways to vote, so please see the bulletin for details. And all the other announcements and prayer items, please see the bulletin. Yeah, ask Pastor Alex for benediction.
Let's for Sunday school today, let's begin at 11:10, okay? Just because we're ending a little bit later today, give us a chance to stretch out a bit. 11:10, for Sunday school, I want to invite you to come. The question is this: why are our souls so thirsty? How does it get quenched? That's our Sunday school today. Let's all stand as we finish up our time with the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Please have a seat.